you've been traveling. You've been away. You've been, in this case, in Cuba and Miami.
Yeah.
All in 1 week. That must have been quite a head spinner.
You know, which way, yeah. yeah.
Was it fun to take it to Cuba? Was it a different, what was that experience?
Yeah, it was, well, it was fun to take it to Cuba. It's, you know, it was brave to take it to Miami and had to be done. To Cuba, was, you know, we didn't know what to expect. But, you know, you can take Che out of Cuba, but you can't take Cuba out of Che. So it was pretty interesting to see the people react to the film. They know that history very well. Mm-hmm. And to see, you know, an American movie present their history was very interesting to see their reaction. Overall was, you know, was good.
That's a big theater that they show it in, right?
Yeah, they showed it in two. The Yara, which is, I think it's 2,500 people. Yeah. And the Karl Marx, which I think it sits about 5,000 people.
So you're sitting it with the real people. You're not. This is not just some sort of political group that's watching with you.
No, definitely. There was like a crowd there. And you know, it was a film festival, too, so there's a lot of people from Latin America and a lot of people from all over the world, really.
So did you feel a strong embrace, or were you never quite sure?
No, you know, it warmed up. It warmed up. Yeah, it was. It warmed up, and at the end, it was good.
And then you went on to Miami, which is...
No, we were in Miami.
Oh, you were
before.
Miami first?
Yeah.
Oh, so that's a little safer.
Yeah.
So how rough was it? I mean, I read a couple quotes from you saying that you kind of had to do it, and that, I mean, I've gone through it myself. I did a film festival in Miami and replaced a Cuban who was running it and got slaughtered for it. So I can feel the pain.
Yeah, you know, but, well, there was a protest for the film. My concern was they hadn't seen the movie. Mm-hmm. So it was like, you know, well, they're protesting more of the history. But there were some people in Miami, too, who were interested to see what this movie was about and you know, to see that history somehow interpreted on the cinema. So, you know, it was kind of like a, you know, there was a protest outside. I've never had a movie being protested, so that was the first.
Yeah. So you and Laura Bickford kind of built this machine from the start. So this has been your baby for a long time. It's been 5 years now or 6 years?
Well, when Steven Soderbergh jumped in, it was in 2001, so 7 years.
So did you feel like it's a political movie, or that it's a story that reaches beyond politics?
Well, if reaching beyond politics is history, then, you know, I think it's more of a historical story, but you can't take away that it is political. And that it is a specific time in you know, the 60s, where the Cold War was happening, and then, you know, there was a revolution in Cuba. There were two teams right there, the red team and the blue team. Mm-hmm. The blue team being the red team being China, Russia, the communist part of the world, and the blue team. So you can't help but, if you make a movie about Che or anything that has to do, you know, about Cuba in that time, it's going to be political, and there's things that are relevant today. So it is political, and then there's some of it that is very relevant today. So yeah, you can't avoid it. You know, you can't avoid it to be political. You know, our goal was, filmmakers, was to make it, you know, as honest to our research as possible.
Well, do you have to separate yourself as a producer and a filmmaker and somebody who's creating the idea of this with Steven and with Laura and the rest of the team and the writers and everybody, versus you as an actor, where you come in? Is it a different kind of angle that you come from?
I think the minute we started shooting, I was just an actor. I couldn't be bothered with anything else, logistics or But before that, I was involved in many aspects of the making of the film, and the research, and talking to the writers, and involved in that way. But once the movie started, I could only be an actor. I mean, the movies were shot very fast. There was a lot of dialogue in there, and I had to stay. And Laura knew that, you know, and she knew that, you know, that at some point, you know, she was going to be alone. She got help from Steven and other people too, but you know, at some point, I was just the actor. I was just, you know, working on trying to be true.
So, well, let's go back to the producer part of you for a second. While you're developing this, I mean, one of the things that's most striking about the film is the choices of when you're telling the story of Che, what part of his life, the two elements and how they kind of fit together, the Bolivia period and the Cuba period. Was that something you kind of knew you wanted to go for from the beginning, or?
No, actually, we started working on just the last year of his life on the Bolivian, based on the Bolivian diary. We always felt that we wanted to go. I think Steven and I, early on, we felt we wanted to do something specific about Che. Before, we had a biography, Laura and myself, and then we tried to take that biography to writers to write it. No one could crack it. And, you know, I don't think anyone could do a biography of Che in 2 hours and get to know anything, you know. You can make a documentary, but not a movie. So what happened was at some point I was reading the Bolivian diary, and it's very specific. It's written by Che himself, and it tracks from the moment he lands in La Paz to the last day he was captured alive, pretty much. And we concentrated. I felt this was so specific, and I brought it to Steven, and I said, I think this would be an interesting angle. We started working there, and at some point, when Steven came back in and checked it out, he felt, and I think I felt it too, but I wouldn't say it, but he felt like if this is the man from the T-shirts,
right,
and we only see the last year of his life, we're gonna think he's a lunatic, you know, just a guy who out of the blue goes and tries to, change the order of a country. So Steven then had the idea to use New York as a pivotal moment, and so we started doing research on his time in New York City when he came to speak at the UN. That's 1964, 4 years earlier. I mean, 3 years earlier. And then the Cuban Revolution, which is like 2 years that we compress in 75 minutes, really. And then that pivotal night where he meets Fidel Castro. So in Mexico City, 1956, before the Bolivian, the Cuban Revolution. So I think Steven's structure basically was go specific in all those sections, as specific as we could, to get to know him, to get to like experience something. So we used the New York section, the UN as his interior monologue in a way. But it's the future, you know. It's ahead of, on the first movie, of the Cuban Revolution, which is like he's becoming a leader of the Cuban Revolution, and it's a very important part of Che that he gave up power to do another revolution that he did. He did two. He tried one in the Congo, and then he tried one in Bolivia. And so that's a very interesting quality of Che that we felt like, you know, here's a man that, you know, didn't just got the power and stay there. He just abandoned power.
It seems to me, watching the picture, that there's, particularly because of the structure, but that there's a thing where in the first film that because he has Fidel, who is more ambitious in those ways, that enhances the ability to actually make the revolution happen in a way that the purity of Che and his attitude towards it is separate. And Fidel, you know, cares about the revolution. It's not to put him down in that way, but he wants the power. He wants to run the country. He wants to, to
make his country.
Yeah.
It's his country.
But not Che's.
No Che. Not
he believes Che's. In just freeing the people.
Yeah, he believes in freeing the people, and believes in, like, you know, in freeing the people. He believes, I think Fidel also believes in the same thing, but Fidel had Cuba was his country, and he was going to do it. I think had it happened in Argentina, Che might have stayed in Argentina. Who knows? I don't know. But the difference is, I think that that Che had this idea of, once the success happened in Cuba, his idea was all of Latin America. Mm-hmm. Maybe before it succeeded. It's from the beginning. I think he had this idea of kind of like Simon Bolivar, mm-hmm. A Latin American, you know, one of the forefathers of Latin America, who tried to make South America into one country but failed. Mm-hmm. And so I think Che was. I had that same idea.
So do you come to it with a different, do you come to the two different movies, which are really, for me, completely part of one movie? It's really,
I think it is.
I don't see how it works as one movie in a way.
It's, right. No.
It's fascinating. Out of Cannes, a lot of the conversation was, well, I like the first one. Oh, I like the second one. Like, how can you not?
It's one. In my opinion, choices were made on one. When we were making choices, and as we were making the film, Stephen and I, we would talk about, oh well, we did that on the first movie. Mm-hmm. We don't need to do it now. We have mm-hmm. plenty of that, you know. Like for example, you know, dealing with people dying by his side. You know, mm-hmm. on the second movie, you have two or three that are really specific, and right. we spend time with that. On the first movie, we just skim mm-hmm. on it. And there were moments, there were written of moments of people dying and him just trying to save him as a doctor in the field, as a war doctor. And we said, well, we don't need to do it because we have it on the second one. Mm-hmm. We talked in terms of the second one, but it was one. It's always been one. It's always been one. And I like to think about it. I was working as one. Steven mm-hmm. was working as one, I'm sure.
So yeah. They're not separate approaches for you. They're really...
No, it's just one.
Because you know what the ending is, obviously, as an actor.
Right. I mean, as separate as one scene from another,
right.
as an actor, yeah. but it's the same movie. It's the same character for me. They were shot like...
So is he a different guy by the time you get to the second half of the story?
I mean, yeah, I think he's a little bit different, you know, as much as a character can be different.
So how do you play that, or do you? Or...
You just don't... You walk... You know, I don't know. How do you play that? I think that, you know, you just let things come to you a little bit more instead mm-hmm. of... going to it, you know. You know, you play a little. It's hard to play young, mm-hmm. but I think it's impossible to play really young. But what you do is like you do what you can to show his being timid, and it's in the first picture you see him, the way he looks at Fidel, the way he listens to Fidel, the mm-hmm. way he gets reprimanded by Fidel, his boss. So you know, it's the way you know on the second one there's no one looking down on him, he's doing it to other people.
But is he? I mean, but he doesn't become. He's not quite as tough as Fidel, is he? In the second one.
I don't think he. I don't think he. You know.
I mean, this is one of the big discussions, I guess, of the picture is whether he's vicious enough for some people.
I know what happened.
The dark side.
Well, I think that he was a little bit less. He was. He might have not been as astute as Fidel or let's say, I don't know, I want to use the word street mm-hmm. or you know, but Fidel had a whole base when he got to Cuba with mm-hmm. the grandma. There were people helping him, and it is hinted in the second movie, at the beginning of the second part of the one movie. Mm-hmm. It is hinted when Fidel says, you know, you can wait. It is dangerous now to go so early on. There's mm-hmm. no, you know, and Che, being the guy that he was, he felt like he had to be there for the other guys. He mm-hmm. had to be there for the team, and so he went to Bolivia. I think in my opinion, a little bit prematurely. You know, and but that was one of the qualities that made him into like a special guy. He would call orders, but he would do them too.
He was always getting his hands dirty
in
both of these stories.
Yeah,
but though it does feel like the first picture is almost the whole journey to the revolution is almost like a victory lap already. I mean, it's like there seems to be love in that country that you feel through each of the small towns, each of the journeys, and they so reflected in the Bolivia side, where
there was a
people were suspicious and not sure.
Yeah, there was a government in Cuba that had been, there had been a resistance in going on in Cuba for a few years before Che and Fidel arrived mm-hmm. in the grandma, since from the beginning of the film. and there had been a lot of the government, the Cuban government at the time had been, there were many acts of terrorism towards the population, and there was a lot of anger towards that government. Mm-hmm. So Che going there and Fidel going there, there was an element of like they could really turn the tide, even though it was not easy. They could really get the people to follow them because people were looking for leadership.
And Bolivia, not so much.
Well, Bolivia is a little bit different. Bolivia, I think that he wanted to train first. Basically, what he did in Cuba, they train in Mexico and then they go to Cuba. Well, Che was going to do the training in Bolivia and do it in Bolivia, hide in Bolivia, and then do it in a training camp. And I think that was a gamble there, and he would make decisions and go for it. I think maybe that's one of his faults, his impulsiveness, his quick to draw. Mm-hmm.
Do you feel like after doing all of this for so many years that you know this man, or is there any way of doing that from the distance of history?
I think I know more than you, probably.
No question about that.
But maybe, I don't know. But I don't know if I know enough to be, there's people that know a lot, and there's people that, especially in Cuba, there's a lot of people that were with him. They're still alive.
Did you get to speak to many of those?
I got to speak to some of them, yeah. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of scary in a way, but scary in a good way. I feel like I do know a little bit, but if anything, he opened up a whole, door to Latin American history and Caribbean history. I knew a little bit because of my background being Puerto Rican. We share, Puerto Rico and Cuba share the same history. Fighting for the independence from Spain and the Spanish-American War and all that stuff, So there's a little bit of history there that is similar that I knew already.
We're in the subway, apparently. But so you learned the history more. But
I think it opened up opened up this door to like learning about the history, Cuban history, Caribbean history, Latin American history, history of the period.
Do you still get surprises? I mean, when you go to Miami and people are talking to you, or people go to Cuba on a trip like this, are there still things that come to you that you go, oh, that hadn't hit me quite that way before? Or?
Yeah, you're always, I don't know if I have any examples per se, but I'm sure that you always get surprises,
And did you have a chance to spend much time in Cuba before making the picture, just to get a sense of Cuba?
Well, yeah, we went to Cuba. We did research in Cuba. The research all over the world, really.
Right.
But we did a lot of legal trips to Cuba, and we went to Cuba. We met with people that knew him there. We met with his second wife. Met with his son, daughters. Met with combatants that were with him in Cuba, combatants that were with him in Bolivia. Mm-hmm. We met people in France. There was the people, combatants that were with him in France, that are in France, living in France. So,
and it's a wild room. Sorry.
Maybe that's a Che movie.
So you went, and so this all started the journey. This part of the journey, the part of actually showing the picture to people and getting the response, you started in Cannes.
Started in Cannes, yeah.
So was that? I mean, it was. It seems like the politics there were all over the place on this picture. They weren't really.
Well, I think I think there was there were a couple of reviews that were like really, prickly.
Yeah.
To say the least, and then but there was other reviews that were very positive about the film.
But when somebody gives you the prickly review, somebody's giving you, and there's a read in it that says, okay, this is about the politics of Che as a man and not about this movie we've made. Do you see it that way? Do you see that there's any way of separating them? Or?
You know what? This movie does something very interesting that I think that there's very few movies that have done this. I don't know of another Hollywood movie right now that comes to mind that have done this. This is a Hollywood movie, let's say. It's Laura Bickford, Steven Soderbergh, and it's myself. We met in Hollywood. We've been doing Hollywood movies. Whether we do independent movies or this, we're taught by the Hollywood system, if there's such a thing. But Southern California, let's put it that way. So here's a movie, a Hollywood movie, that assumes the position of another country, Cuba, and in a way, criticizes some of the elements of the American government. And that's, I don't know many other Hollywood films that do that.
No.
And so it's kind of strange, and I think people are thrown by it. And also the style, the way Steven told the story. It's very honest, and in my opinion, bravo for that, because I like movies and I like that. But we took history, and the history of Che is like this long. Well, you can't fit that in two movies. You can't fit that in three movies. You probably need 11 movies for that. But we need to do two movies. All right. So we took a chunk here, a chunk there, and a chunk there. And I think we kind of summarized the man and the period and the time, and then put all that together, and then very honestly present that as a story. And I think it's honest, and
Well, one of the things that's so amazing about it is that you really do feel like you know all the characters. As you were saying from the beginning of the conversation, that the time that is taken with characters that in a Hollywood movie traditionally would be, Ensign Pulver or Ensign Joe or whatever goes off to get
Right.
blown up. Here, every time somebody gets shot, you feel like somebody has been shot, which is a very different way of approaching any war movie, really.
Well, yeah, I guess I don't. I'm glad that that's your feeling, So.
That's what it's about. And when you saw the picture, I mean, did you obviously you went in and you became an actor, and then you go and look at this footage that Steven went on and shot with whatever technology he's evolving with. But it's a stunningly beautiful visual movie. Did you know that? Was it a surprise to you? Was it breathtaking when you?
Yeah, it was a surprise to me. Some things are, also the way that camera, translates onto cinema, onto the big screen, the red cam. But yeah, it was, and the style of just, staying put and not manipulating by doing close-ups or camera movements, just staying put and being very, you could say cold, but to me is honest and not manipulative, And there's movies that need to be manipulated, but his choice to doing this one without the manipulation of close-ups or moving the camera and making you trying to get something from the audience, I think is very honorable, and I very very I like it. It's unique, and I think it might throw some people off,
But I think it's probably throws them off trying to get him into the theater more than once they've sat in that movie theater. I mean, it's amazing. We saw it at the Chinese. The second time I'd seen it, I'd gone to Toronto. I'd seen it in
Oh,
Toronto,
okay, yeah.
and then we went to this big screen at the Chinese, and nobody left. And everybody's kind of waiting to see what would happen after the first 2.5 hours, two
Right,
hours and 11 minutes, whether people would take off and go have dinner. There's enough already. But I would say there were maybe 10 seats when we came back to the theater. They were completely with that movie. And even this weekend, you guys are opening this weekend in New York and LA only, and you've sold out every screening so far.
That's because I bought about 700 tickets this morning.
It's your favorite
Yeah,
movie
it's my
ever.
favorite movie. We gotta buy the tickets. Buy a 700. 700. 700. Just buy the front rows. Yeah. No, but it's great. I mean, it's great.
So at this point, the award season is upon us, and everybody's talking about that. Is it matter to you much outside of selling more tickets and getting more people to see this movie, or?
Well, there's been some awards already that haven't been too generous with
No.
Che or the movie or Steven or anyone involved in the movie. So, but no, I expect nothing when it comes to that. I have to. And there's a lot of, I saw the list of the Golden Globes. There's a lot of really good actors. I haven't seen their latest work, but I know their work, and they're great actors. And when it comes to the actors, like, who am I to say, hey, man, bump one of those so I can run on there? Because they're all very good actors that I've known, and I've seen their work for years, and I'm sure they're great in this movie. So, it's all good.
It's a weird cycle.
It is, yeah.
What do you mean? Do you sit there going, okay, maybe DGA for Steven, and that's really what's important? Or do you, I mean, do you, it's like.
Well, it'd be great if they recognized the movie, but that would be really, that's a long shot.
Why?
For
Really?
different reasons. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. Maybe it's because it's in Spanish, or maybe it's because it's like it's politically not, what they want. I don't know. But but there's like the awards are good. You know, they're good, they're fun. Mm-hmm. You know, I like watching them.
Do you go to a lot of movies?
Do I go to a lot of movies? I haven't lately, but
you've been actually working your ass off promoting this movie.
Yeah.
You've done more for this movie than most actors do. You've been really out there.
Well, you know, the other thing is that it's been sold in different territories by different people, and so you know, you have to go to South America and show this movie, and been to Europe, I'm going to Japan, and
So what does it play like in Japan?
I don't know.
Oh, you haven't gone yet?
I'm going to go there, but...
So is there any place where you've been shocked by the reaction, where you've gone, I didn't expect that particular reaction?
Everything has been positive, pretty much, for the people who sit down and watch the movies.
Right.
I think the shock was Miami, in a way. You know, the protest outside the movie theater was kind of like... It might sound cool, and I might look back and say, oh, that was kind of cool. But when you're in the middle of it, it's not great. You know, there's a lot of work, and you want people to, like, support the movie and like the movie. You do it so that people will like the movie.
But do you want to talk to those people and explain to them at all?
No, there's nothing I can explain. I mean, they have to see the movie, and they should criticize the movie for whatever. And they have their criticisms about the movie. But, you know, you can't do it all.
And a few years ago, I was saying I did the Miami Film Festival, and in Toronto the year the festival before, about 6 months before Miami, there was a very pro-Castro documentary from the BBC. And I wanted to show it in Miami as, you know, and say, we think this is propaganda, because we did. I felt that the piece was, you know, pretty, it was a love letter to Fidel and eliminated all the negative stuff. And they wouldn't let me do it because they were afraid I'd get shot. They actually thought I'd be killed.
Oh, really?
We showed that, because Miami, it was such a severe... The reaction is so allergic to anything that's...
But you know what? I read not too long ago, just about, really about 8 hours before I got on a plane to go to Miami. There is a poll that is done by, I forgot the name of the university, the University of Miami, but they do this poll. They've been doing this poll since 1991, where they asked Cuban Americans if they're pro or against the embargo. And for the first time ever, Cuban Americans, the majority of Cuban Americans are against the embargo of Cuba. That's really interesting.
It's a huge shift.
And it's at least in that poll. But I think it's interesting, and I think some people. I've talked to Cuban Americans who see the movie for what it is, and kind of like are interested in learning more, maybe, maybe.
So when you go off,
things roll the way they have to roll.
It's a change. I mean, I think the strangest thing about going to Cuba is getting American change. You know, the money in Cuba is owned nothing but American money, and you're kind of like, what happened to the embargo? Why is this happening? I found it very surreal. So is going to do a movie like The Wolfman, now delayed, a relief?
No. I finished that movie.
You finished it, but they're holding off on releasing it.
I think they're releasing it in November.
In November. Yeah. So, but I mean, is going off to do a movie like that for you a relief? Is that just like a...
Or a release. Yeah. It was, it was good to be as inventive and as, you know, as you can be. You know, you can come up with ideas that are like, you know, you don't have to, like, when you do a historical character like Che Guevara, you have to be very respectful to history, and you gotta look at your books, you gotta really, like, be respectful to history, and that can be tedious. When you do a character like the Wolfman, you can be as over the top as you want to be, and as silly as you can be, and you know, so it's fun, because it's all, one is you have to paint within the lines, the other one, anything goes, you know.
What is a movie like Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, where you put on the weight and playing a wild character but is also a real character? Is that somewhere in the middle? Or
Hunter Thompson used to call that book a nonfiction novel. And, you know, even if it was Oscar Acosta, Dr. Gonzo was, the real Dr. Gonzo was Oscar Acosta. In the book, he was still, like, fiction based on Oscar, but still fiction. So I could, you know, I could still, you know, they were doing even, and they also were doing even drugs that do not exist, you know, the drugs like the pineal gland or whatever. So they're doing stuff that doesn't even exist. And you know, it's just like you can take chances there. You can you can invent a little bit. And what was amazing is the dialogue. You have to listen. But that's another interview.
So is that for you? I mean, is this mixture of things what you want to do forever? I mean, is it
why
small
not?
Movie, big movie, small movie? This is it just.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Every flavor.
I'd like to, like, you know, I like to do, you know, I to me, like, Fear and Loathing in a way was kind of like another one of those movies when we showed it in Cannes was great response in the audience, like Che, great response in the audience, but then the American newspapers or reviewers were terrible.
Yeah.
Like Che. So, and then, but the movie found its audience, and I hope that the Che movie will do that too. I mean, hopefully before, you know, before it's too late.